say in Hansberg, the president said that when he came into office, inflation was skyrocketing, but it was 1.4% in January of 2021, and that was the 11th consecutive month at that time under 2%. So was the president misleading Americans?
So when the president took office, and you know this, there was a pandemic. It was closing down businesses, closing down schools. And so it was drastically disrupting the supply chain. Let's not forget about that. And so that's what was going on. And that caused inflation around the world to increase. We know that. And then further increasing inflation was the Russia's war in Ukraine. And in fact, many other countries are even worse off because of what we've seen with Russia's war. So the president took historic action to deal with the disruption of the supply chain. Let's not forget what he did with the Strategic Petroleum Reserve. And so we have made progress in lowering costs. We've made progress in dealing with inflation. But that's what was happening when we walked in, the pandemic, the disruption of the supply chain. All of these things were happening when the president took office.
Dana Lash here with you. It's Friday. And there's a bunch of odds and ends that we have to attend to before we get you set up for the weekend. And obviously, there are continual denial over the economy is one of them. But also some of the latest stuff that I've been seeing with Iran. And I've got some questions that might seem kind of obvious to some folks. So, I mean, you know, maybe to us, but maybe not so much the other folks. But we're going to get into all of that. And we're also going to talk about some of this other stuff, some of these other stories. I was talking about that Dexter Reed shooting last night on Jesse Waters' program. So we're going to talk about that a little bit as well. But first off, we talked about the CPI numbers that came out Wednesday. The economy's bad. I'm not going to relitigate all that and go into all of it. You know, but the denials from the administration, I'm telling you, it doesn't look good. When you're the administration and you're denying what people are seeing, you realize what that does to voter confidence and how that also translates into voter enthusiasm, which, by the way, we're going to talk about some 2024 stuff. It's a hot mess. You can't lie to people about this stuff. Now, on the border, because they do the same thing with the border issue. I know you guys saw this. This is one of the top stories today. You had a 48-year-old dude named Muhammad Karwin, and he's out on bond for some reason. Why? Can I just stop there for a moment? Why? He is an illegal alien from Afghanistan. Why is he out on bond? Why? He's not in the country illegally, but that's not all. He's literally on the terror watch list. Like, he's actually a terrorist. He's a real-life terrorist. He does terrorist stuff. And he was arrested in, early March. He was arrested in early March near the U.S.-Mexico border. He was already, check this out, he was already in the United States for a whole year before he was arrested and then had to be released by Border Patrol in 2023. So he was in the country illegally for a year. Border Patrol arrests him. And remember, they can't really do anything. The administration won't let them do anything. So then he was released by an immigration judge. And the judge was told that the guy was a national security threat by Border Patrol. And the judge lets him walk anyway. By the way, you know how sometimes when people are released on bond and you have certain restrictions, you know, especially, I would just think if you're a big, giant, fatty, fat terrorist like this guy, he has no restrictions. He's able to walk around the country freely, has zero restrictions at all whatsoever. He was treated, from what was reported, just like any other average, everyday illegal alien that crosses and breaks into the country, and they process, they do all this stuff, and they let him go. Now, the other insane part of this is that even though you had a Border Patrol arrest the guy, apparently the FBI wasn't notified. In Customs, and you have Customs and Border Patrol, then you have Customs Enforcement. Customs Enforcement also apparently wasn't notified. Now, what gets me is that, and there's a couple of pieces I'm looking at here. Like, this is Free Beacon. When this guy was arrested, Border Patrol agents were they something tipped them off. Like they saw this, they saw his name, and they were running his name against, you know, the terror watch list, and lo and behold, there was a match. Now, they needed other corroborating information at the time to confirm that this Mohammed Karwin guy was the terrorist that they suspected. But the government never told us what made them run his name, what made them suspicious, what was the information that made them think, oh my gosh, we gotta cross-reference this dude's name. He can fly in the U.S. Yeah. He's on the terror watch list. He's literally a known terrorist. And he can fly. You guys know that, right?
No.
Oh, you didn't? Yeah, he can fly.
I thought that was like literally one of the prerequisites of getting on the no-fly list was being on the terror watch list.
Yeah, no, apparently not. We actually don't know the criteria that gets somebody on the no-fly list. I don't know if you guys know that either. That's never been made public. We have no idea what the criteria that gets somebody on the no-fly list. We don't know. But yeah, this is... So, and the FBI is responsible for said terror watch list. They're responsible for it. And you have like almost 2 million people who have names on this list, and they're on the terror watch list. And this guy literally is on it. He is a member of a group called Hezbi-e-Islami. And it is literally a paramilitary terrorist group, as so designated by the United States. It is declared to be a virulently anti, can't even talk today, anti-Western insurgent group. A virulent anti-Western insurgent group. Oh. And they were enemies of the Afghan government that the United States had backed. They were enemies of that government. And they worked with the Taliban to help it collapse after Biden abandoned it in 2021. The group that this guy is a member of has killed, at least that we know of, nine U.S. soldiers and civilians over the past several years. So just to run down the list, the guy is literally a known domestic terrorist. He's known, and it's apparently they have the evidence to corroborate it. He's a member of a known terrorist group that actually killed Americans, killed our soldiers, killed civilians, and is a declared enemy of the United States, and was allowed to walk and can fly, can get on a plane, can do whatever, can roam about freely in the United States. And not only was he apprehended once, but he was apprehended twice. And he was released both times. What is one of the things that we heard DC talk about? What was Andy McCabe testifying about yesterday, Kane? Four members of the House.
The warrants? You're talking about
the FISA warrants.
Yeah. Warrant requirements.
Yeah, the warrant requirements. And one of the sound bites that came out of that hearing was they were demanding warrantless surveillance. And they actually said that we will have more terror attacks without this warrantless surveillance. If you don't let us have it, we're going to have, I mean, that's just something that's going to happen, guys. We're going to have more terror attacks. There's a number of them who said that. John Brennan had a piece where John Brennan, I know, of all the people. Guy who lied under oath about spying on Americans. They were saying, well, you know, you got to, if we don't have this, then we're going to have more terror attacks. It is really hard, even harder for me to take them seriously on wanting to protect the United States from terror attacks when they don't do anything to secure the southern border or any border of the United States, southern, northern, whatever. It makes me not take them seriously about protecting the United States from terror attacks when they allow a guy like this. And by the way, this isn't the first, second, third, fourth, or fifth, I could go on, known terrorist who has been on a list, who has crossed over into the United States and was released. This is not the first one, and it won't be the last one. released the guy, released a national security threat. It's hard for me to take these people seriously on wanting to protect the country when they don't take it seriously to protect the country. And they let known active terrorists run loose in the United States interior. Furthermore, it's hard for me to take these people seriously because they went on and on and on about the threats to the government that these people who went into the Capitol on January 6th that they posed. Oh my gosh, can you believe it? Now, some of them were destructive, and they all already had the book thrown at them, but that's been a while ago now. They're just going after the people who showed up. There are people who literally entered the Capitol after being waved in by security, looked around at the statues in Statuary Hall, and left, and they're facing, like, prison time. Meanwhile, you can be an actual literal terrorist, and you can come in through the southern border, be arrested twice, released twice. And who paid for his bond? His bond was $12,000. No questions as to who paid for his bond. Nobody knows. Nobody's got any answers. How was his twice entry now illegally into the United States financed? Because you don't enter into the southern border unless you pay the cartel. I don't care who you are. You do not go through that southern border unless you pay the toll, and that's to the cartel. So who financed all that? How did this guy get in? Who did he get in and go stay with? Nobody has any answers to this, and I'm not joking. They literally have no answers to this. Reporters are starting to ask, and the government's not answering. So based on this information, you know, when I hear people like Andy McCabe and everybody else sit here and talk about this stuff, I don't take them seriously. If they were serious about securing the border, they would have dealt with us. It's not a question of if, it's a question of when we're going to have an incident here in the interior of the United States at this point. And the people who can do something about it refuse to do something about it because they insist there isn't a problem. That's the problem. We have a lot more on the way, including Iran. So they're threatening a strike. Why are we not sanctioning the hell out of them? I got questions. We're going to talk about that. We're going to get into 2024. Biden's launching a seven-figure ad buy on abortion in Arizona. I told you. We're going to talk about this and how Republicans in Arizona are absolutely falling apart at the seams over this. It's insane. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So I simultaneously love and am also terrified of this headline. Now, imagine if this was your dog. And dog lovers out there, I know you're hearing me. Pet parents, I love pet parents, really. They're owners, but come on, I get you. This dog's owners used a drone because he's a husky and they were missing him. And they were like, where's our dog at? And they found the dog playing with a group of bears, an actual group of bears, wild brown bears. And the video, the husky was trailing them, circled them. He was all excited. And one bear tried to nudge the dog away when it got too close, but they weren't threatening. It was weird because it's like the bears were looking at him like, why are you so cracked out? Like it's hysterical. I watched this video like a million times last night because there's three of them and he's walking with him. He's like, hi, can I come with you? Can I go with you? And the bears are like, will you stop? And one of them just kind of nudges him away. But he's like, they weren't threatened by him and he wasn't threatened by him. It's just funny. I don't know. But thankfully, everybody was okay. Scientists are urging people to lay off the lobster and shrimp because of dangerous levels of cancer-causing forever chemicals. And they said it's the PFAS. They're associated with cancers, not just cancers, but infertility, birth abnormalities, blah, blah, blah. Seafood's a major source of it. And they said that even tap water, I don't know. That's bug meat. So I'm okay with that. If you said, Dana, you cannot ever eat lobster again, I'm like, ooh, okay. Don't threaten me with a good time. It's bug meat. It is. It really is. Jim Gaffigan was right. And that's the only thing he's right about. Harvard is bringing back their standardized test because guess what? Racism doesn't work. Yeah. So they stopped using racism for admissions. And they've announced that they're reinstituting standardized testing as a requirement for admissions. Wow. Because they've been sucking out loud. That's why. It's been horrible. A truck got robbed of more than $12,000 in pork in Northeast Philly while the driver slept. More than $12,000 in pork stolen from this truck. This sounds like an Always Sunny in Philadelphia episode. It's the 37th cargo theft just in that area that year. Stick with us. We got more in store. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
We talked about at the conference overall. We talked about stability. We talked about making sure that the third world, the southern hemisphere had access to change. It had access. It wasn't confrontational at all.
You came with me. Thank you, everybody. This ends the press conference. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Oh my gosh! Did they seriously start playing that music?
I've raised it with every person I've met with.
Mr. President, are you worried about your son being indicted, Mr. President?
Oh my, that's so awkward. Oh, can one cringe to death? Because I think I did. I just cringed right the hell out of my chair watching that, like as we were coming into the show. Good night. That's so awkward. Dude, that's awkward. Welcome back to the program. Dana Lash with you, your lovable curmudgeon. Bottom of this first hour here. Listen coast to coast. You can also stream the radio program. You can find us on X, even channel 347 Direct TV as well. So I think he's gonna have to have a nap today. I don't know what his schedule entails today. Usually doesn't entail much because he kind of calls a lid at like noon most days. But they worked him out with a state visit. And that was him taking some questions about, I guess he was talking about Gaza in there because you couldn't hear what he was saying immediately. But now, something about 2024 here, because Arizona should not be in play. Do you know why Arizona should not be in play for the left? Because it's a beautiful state, first off. Arizona is beautiful. It is just, I love the desert. I love heat. It is just one of the prettiest areas. It's kind of like if you were going to put Borderlands anywhere, you'd probably, you know, the game, you'd probably do it in Arizona. You know what I'm saying? Because it's, you know, it's similar. But I don't know why there's why it's even a battle. I mean, I do, but just think about it for a moment. It's the desert, right? It takes a certain kind of person to live out in the desert, even with all the modern conveniences of air conditioning and water coming right to your home. It's still, you know. Desert requires a hardy type of person to live out there, right? And when I generally think of statists, I have to be honest with you, I don't think of hardy people. When I think of statists, I think of starving people who are sick and have horrible representation because they've got tyrants running the show. So that's, you know, just by way of geography, it's wild to me. But abortion is making it a thing. And we've touched on this a little bit, the whole issue of the abortion case in Arizona. And I think people should realize, too, it's not that anybody made law about abortion in Arizona in absence of a federal law. When Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health undid Roe v. Wade, then Arizona's own law kicked in. So when I hear Democrats going, oh my gosh, it's going back to the Civil War, 1846, before the Civil War, that's when... Well, why didn't you not do anything in that state for so long? I mean, if Democrats were so worried about it, why did they not do anything state by state? What are all you people donating to, like, the Planned Parenthoods and all these, you know, pro-abortion groups on the left? The hell did you all get for the return on your investment? Because you apparently didn't get any action in Arizona from Democrats. So don't get mad at the Constitution of Arizona because they had a statute that kicked in absence of federal law. That's exactly what happened in Arizona. It was essentially a statutory decision. They're like, yeah, well, this is the law. In absence of a federal law, this is what kicked into gear. It's back to states' rights. So Democrats are mad. But I think one of the reasons why they're trying to distract you with their rage is because they want to hide the fact that they sat on their ass in Arizona and didn't do anything. Think about this. They just focused nationally. Their whole strategy was national. They had no plan B. Just like always, they never have any plan. Democrats never have a plan B. That's how you get Biden. They had no other strategy. They didn't do anything. Now, if Arizona was that much into play and people were that freaked out because they're really trying with the messaging, why didn't they have a ground game? Why wasn't there any kind of organization from these pro-abortion groups in Arizona? Now, there are exceptions for the life of the mother, et cetera, to this law. That's why all these newspapers have to be careful in saying, well, it bans abortion outright, because it doesn't. You just can't be using it as a form of birth control. That's what they're saying. I mean, is there some states where I mean, it really doesn't go further than what some other states have. And if they're mad about it, again, you had literally since 1846 to change it, and you didn't. So that's not on Republicans. That's on y'all. That's just what the law is there. And they have exceptions for, like I said, just like every other state does. I don't know why the left tries to act like that doesn't exist, because it does. I've been disappointed with the way that some Republicans have been acting on this. I feel like Trump is trying to triangulate, but his messaging is bad. When it gets to in the weeds on stuff like this, Trump needs to hip fire a little less, because the triangulation on the issue to try to keep certain states in play is not a bad consideration if you're looking at winning elections. And that's one thing I want to point out. I understand, and as someone who defines himself as pro-life, and I'm not going to try to justify strategy again, there are people that are solely focused on the issue of life. And that's, you know, everybody has one issue that they solely focus on, some folks. If you are the Republican nominee, you got to be looking at every issue. You have to win the election first. So I think amongst the right, there's two different things. You have the people who think an incrementalist approach is going to be more successful than an all or nothing. And I agree with that. And then you have folks who are solely focused on the issue of life. And then you have folks who also are pro-life, but they also have realize they got to win elections. And sometimes practicality can be frustrating, but that's the reality of it. We don't live in a world where you can go all or nothing and, you know, and then you'll respawn when you're defeated. That's not how this works. And I think that people need to realize that. But it doesn't help when you have Trump go out there, like I said, and use phrases like abortion rights, etc. And it also doesn't help because with this, I mean, maybe they'll come up with some amendments to it. Maybe they'll have some amendments that they'll add in, you know, about, I guess, you know, time, whatever, 6 weeks, 15 weeks, whatever. But when I see Carrie Lake, and I know a lot of people like Carrie Lake, I don't dislike Carrie Lake. And I want people to realize this. I don't like or dislike a politician. I am ambivalent because they are pieces on the chessboard to me. When you get into the general election, I don't give a rat's backside about your anything. You are a piece on the chessboard to me. I'm a voter. That's how all voters should be looking at these politicians, by the way. People get too invested. They're not idols. They are useful tools for you to advance your agenda. And they are nothing more than that. No offense, that's the reality of stuff. They know the game when they sign up. So like I said, I don't dislike Carrie Lake. I do think that she looks bad in the abortion fight in Arizona because it highlights the fact that she is a brand new Republican. And she is. She's literally a recent Republican. Like 2016 was the first time she ever, you know, was Republican. And I don't have a problem with convincing people to come over to the side of limited government and constitutionality. I'm totally fine with that. Is that not the whole point of what we do? To persuade people to come over to our side, right? To persuade people to come to your cause. I'm watching this show right now called Shogun. It's fantastic, by the way. Parts of it. Some parts drag on a little bit, and sometimes the Blackthorn British dude is a little overwrought. But, you know, other than that, it's a very interesting story. And the head warlord, who might be creating another shogunate, he's very smart in that he realizes when he gets a new ally, and he's all fine with having a new ally, like this guy that they call, you know, the Anjin. He's this British guy who's, you know, he's there in Japan, and they're getting ready to break out into open warfare. It's the Edo period. And this warlord, he's very, very smart in that he knows when he has a new ally. This Anjin is a new ally to him. He gets it. But he doesn't immediately make him his second in command. He doesn't immediately make him in charge of everything. He doesn't immediately make him a thought leader within his clan. There's gradients of this. He's an ally, but you're not going to put him in charge of a whole bunch of stuff yet. And this is where I get really frustrated with the conservative movement. Because you have Republicans and you have conservatives. And conservatives are so damn desperate. Not all, but the ones that are a little bit more Republican than they are conservative are so damn desperate for popular relevancy. And they are so damn desperate to look cool and to look relevant and to look as though they are competitive that they will excitedly lap up any praise and they will embrace any new person that comes along that might make them look a little bit more with it, and they will crown them the next thought leader without a moment's hesitation. How many times have you seen this? This is where they hurt themselves. Because this isn't about not welcoming people to your side. It's about putting people in charge of it right when they come in the door. Having them be a thought leader. Having them lay down the rules and put the items into motion what you're going to advance in the next election and how you're going to message it. That's pretty significant, especially if you're somebody who's brand new in the movement and you haven't been tempered by at least a couple of elections. You haven't had to really defend your ideals for quite a long time. You haven't been in the trench with everybody. My rule is that if you're too good to serve, then you're not good enough to lead. And this is kind of my problem with a lot of the stuff that I see, particularly on the right. The left doesn't do this because they're psycho. They will circle the wagons. That's why they don't have a bench either. But the right is a little too thirsty. And I think some of that does come into play with Carrie Lake because she's running away from pro-life right now. And pro-life groups are livid with her. And other Republicans in Arizona are mad at her. And now you got the Republican Party in a just massive brawl right now in Arizona. So case in point, this headline, Arizona Republican leaders block effort to repeal abortion ban, screaming shame, shame. Oh, they're fighting. They're very, very, and I get it. They're worried about how this is going to play into the election. But they're also worried about, you know, you can't compromise on certain principles. I think there's a way to message this without having to run away from your position on stuff. So Lake had disavowed the Republican or the disavowed the ruling. She had come out against it. And she said, I oppose the ruling. I'm calling on the Democrat Governor Katie Hobbs and the state legislature to come up with an immediate common sense solution that Arizonans can support. Well, that phrase right there immediately got me as a gun owner. Common sense. Common sense. Why are we using phrasings like that? But in 2022, she was asked about this ban, and she said that the ruling upholds is a great law and that it sets an example for other states. What? So she flip-flopped on it. She had that position until the heat got hot. This is what I'm talking about. You got to be tempered by several elections. You got to be tempered for a little bit before you start shooting for the top. Now, I think her remarks and her posturing is way more problematic than Trump's is. Because now Lake looks like a moderate, and she is. I'm not saying that as an insult. She's a moderate. Trump is also a moderate. But he can govern conservatively. There's a difference. I think that Trump is trying to triangulate, and I don't, like I said, I don't think that that's a bad strategy to have. He's got to be very careful here because he needs his base, and he also needs the people who are not being told the whole picture about Arizona, and they might be believing some of the stuff that they're seeing with Democrats. Like I said, Biden's launching a seven-figure ad buy. They want to make this is what Democrats want to do. They want to make this all about abortion. All about abortion. We're going to talk more about that here coming up. We also have on the way, we got Days of These United States. We got some culture too. Iran, the latest. So you know how important being prepared is to me. And that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of the United States.
Harmful disregard of someone's preferred chosen pronouns directly conflicts with the message that we want to affirm people and let adults and encourage adults to live their best lives. Further, I want to say that gender-affirming care for all ages is a range of treatment. It's a range of choices they make, from clothes, from name to hair, and yes, pronouns. And when we misuse pronouns and when we intentionally or deliberately misuse them or choose not to be careful, we're sending messages to our kids also that we don't care how they're seeing the world and we are willing to do them harm. And the very act of doing that is an act of disrespect and violence against people, regardless of who they are.
So this is a Minnesota state representative named Liz Ryer. And she's, language isn't violence, and that's dumb. We're not going to sit here and control people's speech so that you can force them into giving up their rights by affirming your fantasies. Not doing that. That's so goofy. Why do they always sound like that, too? Why do they always sound like that? We have a lot more on the way, including that shooting of three police officers. They were gunned down this morning by a teen in Memphis. We'll talk about that coming up. Stick with us. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it? That's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
Sherry, I saw all the abuses of the FBI, the terrible abuses over and over and over, the hundreds of thousands of abuses. And then when I became speaker, I went to the SCIF and got the confidential briefing from sort of the other perspective on that to understand the necessity of Section 702 of FISA and how important it is for national security. And it gave me a different perspective. So I encourage all the members to go to the classified briefing and hear all that and see it so they can evaluate the situation for themselves. And I think some opinions have changed both ways, but that's part of the process. You got to be fully informed.
Like, he only just now realized this? I'm not playing devil's advocate. I'm asking this like this is Dana's advocate. First off, welcome back to the program. Top of the second hour, Dana Lash here with you. This is why I get super cranky. So he's saying in this audio soundbite, Kane, this is Speaker Johnson. Classified briefings gave me a different perspective on FISA reforms. I mean, not the hell that broke loose after 2016. That didn't give you a different perspective on FISA reforms? See, I'm in a funky place here because if I criticize him too much, we're trying to get him on the show. He's not going to come on the show. That's what happens. I have to throw a tantrum and then publicly shame people, and then they begrudgingly come on and they're like terrified. That's why we can't get certain lawmakers. And I'm very nice. But still, what do you mean you just now got this different perspective on FISA reforms? Like, what did we not know before? What did you not know before that would make you think, well, it might be okay? Right? Am I missing something? I mean, he should know more about this than us because he's there in D.C., right?
Exactly. I would have loved for him to actually articulate what that perspective is that he gained from being in those classified briefings, because he didn't indicate it. He's just like, oh, well, you know, I've changed my mind a little bit on it. But he hasn't said why or the reasons why. He just said that it was those confidential, those classified briefings that he was in.
Well, the House voted for it. They voted to reauthorize, but it was the modified bill that they sent to the Senate for approval. And it's the modified, let me pull this up. It failed earlier this week. This is the modified bill.
And it
reauthorizes the FISA, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. The new version, it authorizes, it's a 2-year authorization instead of 5. So if Trump were to win in November, then he would be in office by the time it expired, meaning he would be there when they're overhauling FISA next time. So Johnson had organized this classified reading for House floor members to view it ahead of the vote today. And that's what he was talking about. He was opposed to the reauthorization of 702, saying that only after he got these classified briefings did he gain a different perspective. I'm going to tell you, I was not privy to the classified briefings, and I can tell you that I was already opposed to it. Mm-hmm. I don't get that line from him. That's a cop-out. Are you kidding me? I can't get past this, so indulge me just for a minute. He's the Speaker of the House. He's in Washington, D.C. And it wasn't until he did not have this realization until he viewed. So wait a minute. Let me ask this. Here's this question. We all opposed it for reasons that are public. What the hell did he learn that's classified that made him, who had supported it up until then, oppose it? Where Where's that at? What did he learn in a classified briefing that made him change his mind? I got some questions. How bad was it? Man, do you know how many times I reach out to lawmakers and I'm like, hey, on stuff like this, I'm like, tell me back channel, just, you know, for background. And when you say off the record, that means you can't use any information. It's not legally binding, by the way. It's a courtesy that everyone, it's de facto law in journalism world, but it's not a law. But if you say off the record, you can't use any of it, not even talking about it in a roundabout way. If you say for background, then you can use it in a roundabout way and use it to help inform your coverage, right? So I'm, and you don't have to identify who told you. I can't tell you how many times I've reached out to lawmakers like, psst, hey, yeah, come here. Can you give me a little information on this? Yeah, give me some background. And I always have to do it real cool. Like, I'm like, hey, saw your whatever. I'll just make something up. This is the nicest I get, right, Kane? Are you shocked about this? How shocked are you?
You get nicer than that. What
no,
are you talking
it's not,
about?
It's not true. I'm getting ready to tell you how much I hate questionnaires here in a minute. I'll reach out. I'm like, hey, just saw your hit. And I never say, hey. I never do that either. I don't even know what the typed equivalent of that is. I'm like, hey, saw your hit. You know, great job. You know, oh, by the way. You know, I set it up. Like, oh, compliment. By the way. Ask. It usually never works. But every now and then I'll get a, well, I can tell you this. I'm not going to tell you who does that. They're not breaking any laws, but they're kind of giving me a little bit more than they would, like, you know, somebody at CNN. But I tell you what. So they have, it's without the added warrant mandate. Again, I just want to know if Speaker Johnson supported it up until when we all opposed it. And he supported it up until he saw the classified stuff. How bad is the classified stuff? That's the question we all want answered. I feel like that's a fair question. Good night. I'm telling you. So did you guys hear this story? I wanted to switch and get into some law and order here. Because I saw this, and I'm bringing this story up, because this was all just this morning. An officer gunned down in Memphis, and he was shot and killed. And one officer was shot and killed. One is in non-critical condition. Another officer was injured as well. This story, and we'll play some of this press conference here in a moment, a clip from that. But it was an 18-year-old. That police were calling the suspect. So it was, you know, a minor. And they responded to a suspicious vehicle call that ended. Again, four people injured. One was transported to the hospital. The officer who was killed, Officer Joseph McKinney. And that's according to the interim police chief, Sarah Lynn Davis. He was part of the Rain Station Alpha Shift. He's joined the department in 2020. It happened at 2 a.m. They responded to this suspicious vehicle call. And when they approached, the officers were shot first, and then they returned fire. This is some of that press conference. Listen to this. This is about this shooting in Memphis.
A total of three officers were struck by gunfire. Tragically, one of our officers lost his life. That officer is Joseph McKinney. He was assigned to the Rain Station Alpha Shift. The second officer was brought here to Regional 1, but thankfully, he has been upgraded to non-critical condition, and he's doing well. The third officer was treated on the scene and is in stable condition. One suspect was 18 years old, and the other suspect is 17 years old. Both suspects were transported to Regional 1 in critical condition. Both of them sustained gunfire as well. One suspect has been pronounced deceased. The 18-year-old suspect was arrested in March 2024 by MPD in a stolen vehicle with an illegal modified semi-automatic weapon with a Glock switch attached. The Glock switch converted the weapon to a fully automatic machine gun. He was also charged at that time for two stolen vehicles and having a programming device commonly used to steal cars. The suspect was released at that time without bond.
I'm sorry, what?
We have notified the district attorney's office.
What? What? He was released?
Yeah, he was out and able to kill that officer because he was previously released.
Why was he not in prison? The second suspect was 17, right? So why was this agent, why was this dude not in prison? Oh, probably because, you know what? Let me pull this up. You know what? I had a piece on this. Probably because you got a Soros-backed DA. Yep. There you go. Yes, that is true. National groups flooding local prosecutor races with money. Super PAC funded by George Soros. This is one of the first hits that came up. George Soros backed DA. Yep. Soros funded progressive DA. Oh, yeah. So there. That's why. That's why he was allowed to walk. Thanks, George Soros and all the left that supports that. So that officer's dead because Soros money and the left got that bad Soros backed DA in there. You know how this, like, often this happens? This is just horrific. And I really feel like I was on Jesse Waters about this last night. I'm telling you, the left is desperately trying to get a summer of rage going. They are desperate. I was sitting there waiting to go live, and Jesse was going through his monologue on that Dexter Reed case. Very similar to this case. You got a youth who just opened fire on cops. Except this one, you got a cop killed. In the case of Reed in Chicago, you had an injured cop. And I'm sitting there and listening to Jesse's monologue, and I was all cool and chill. And I just got pissed. I was sitting there getting enraged because even though, I mean, we knew this, we talked about it yesterday. But I'm sitting there and I'm listening because even more politicians have come out and they're a little quiet today. Because this, even though this happened, you know, a couple months ago, the body footage just came out this week. And I'm sitting there listening to this. And it's amazing to me that immediately people want to find fault with the police. And they're like, well, in the Dexter Reed case, why were there six cops there? I don't know, maybe because the dude already had a warrant out. He had a felony warrant. He was on pretrial release on previous felony weapon charges, three of them. He was wearing a damn ski mask. Did you see that video? He had a ski mask on. Driving around his vehicle with a ski mask. The same car registered to his name. He had his tinted windows. And look, I'm going to tell you, and Kane's right on this. We're from St. Louis, all right? We are from St. Louis. I lived in downtown St. Louis. All right? Cops don't give a rat's backside who you are. You got tinted windows like that, you're getting pulled over. That is how it works. It doesn't matter who you are, what kind of car you're driving. I had a girlfriend who has lived in town and country. Her husband was a paralegal. She lived in town and country. She was driving downtown St. Louis. She got pulled over. Right when you're going in, Kane, on 40, going into downtown because the firm was downtown, she got pulled over because her tinted windows. She had a nice car. I remember when she got those two, and I'm like, you're going to get in trouble because you can't, whether or not you agree with it or not, that's law. How are you going to enforce that? She got pulled over. They cited her for that. She was like, I tried acting sad. I'm like, that's not going to work. It's not going to work for you. They're not going to do that. She totally got cited. Yeah, and she also, guess what? She lived because she didn't open fire on the cops. Yep. We're going to talk more about this here coming up. We got headlines here right now. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
What? What? Kane? So this is Channel 4 in Tennessee. A bill that would make first cousin marriage illegal in Tennessee passes, but not without a fight.
What? Did you say first cousin?
Yeah, first cousin. Oh, hey, you guys.
First cousin.
Yeah, first cousin. I didn't know that you could do that there.
I didn't either.
Apparently, you can until, I guess, now. So you can't marry your first cousin in Tennessee now.
Aren't there genetic negative mutations involved with first cousin loving?
Yeah.
Like idiocy?
I mean, that's why jokes are around. That's literally why jokes exist.
Good God.
I did not know there was a thing. Consider me floored. Actually, on that stupid questionnaire I just had to answer, I'm going to modify my answer and just say that. Let's see. Credit card delinquency rates were worst on record in a new study released. You knew that was coming. They are the highest on record in the fourth quarter, according to the Federal Reserve of Philly. 3.5% of credit card balances are at least 30 days past due. Everybody's putting stuff on credit, too. Drug shortages have reached an all-time high. I mean, Biden's just doing great, guys. We have more in store. Don't miss. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it? That's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
We're helping people by helping pets. So many people will go hungry before they let their pet suffer. They'll share what little food they have with their pet. That's number one. Number two, for many people, their pet is their only family.
Cody's friends partners with local food banks to make sure everyone in the family gets a meal.
There are people who, who are in need, who come for food. And there was one couple that they came up and my wife had asked whether they needed any dog or cat food, and they just started crying because what they had been doing was sharing the food from their table, which they have very little of, with their pet.
And each year they give more and more.
Cody's Friends provides both cat and dog food to people in need, and they distribute 22,000 pounds of pet food each month, which is over $10,000.
The price of pet food has almost doubled, and the need has gone up dramatically. The number of people in need, with the economy as it is, we're seeing a lot more people.
Gosh, that's so sad. This is making me sad. Damn you, Joe Biden. Oh, that's heartbreaking. That is heartbreaking. Welcome back to the program. Goodness. Dana Lash here with you. Now we're all depressed. I'd totally share my food with my dog. I totally would. Yeah, I would. Dogs are the best people sometimes.
I'd go hunt for my dog.
Yeah, I totally would. Yeah. I'd totally share a snack. I mean, unless it was like chocolate or something like that, because that's not good for them, you know, supposedly. So, again, welcome back to the program. Dana Lash with you. You can listen coast to coast, all that good stuff. And this, I'm telling you, the economy, and then now with foreign policy, going from our pets being, feels like, what is that movie I'm thinking of? Dumb and Dumber. Our pets' heads are falling off. Think about it. Good night. I was reading this piece. Iran's threatening the United States. Stay out of fight with Israel or else. You. That would be my response. No, you. What are you talking about? They've threatened to attack American targets, and apparently they're kind of telegraphing a planned assault on Israel. And this is what Axios has been reporting. Jennifer Griffin said to Neil Cavuto earlier that she had never seen things so tense, with the potential, quote, for a wider war breaking out with Israel and Iran, which could draw everybody into a Middle East war. And, well, wait a minute. Well, why does Iran care? Because, oh, wait, that's all their proxy groups. Remember, they always denied, even though everybody knew it, funding Hamas or Hezbollah. They always denied it. But, I mean, what does this tell you exactly? Apparently, U.S. officials said in recent days that Iranians told several Arab governments that they see the U.S. as responsible for the Israeli attack that killed the Iranian general in Damascus. Who cares? Wah. How many of our troops have you killed? Seriously, how many troops has Iran killed? And apparently the country sent a message to the Biden administration through several Arab countries earlier this week that if the U.S. gets involved in the fighting between Israel and Iran, then U.S. forces in the region will be attacked. Yeah, Iran doesn't get to tell us anything. You don't get to tell us nothing. Not a thing. See, again, this is, you know what would be great if the United States was in the position, first off, of having the spine to do this, the political will to do it, and enough people to be able to carry it out. Just position, you know, maybe it's, you know, what's the weapon system I'm thinking of, Kane, where basically it's from space, not a space laser. I can't think of the name of it right now. It's a legit thing.
You're talking about Star Wars?
Like, no. We were worried about Russia having it. I can't think of it. It's Friday. My brain's turning to mush.
I know. I'm kind of fried myself.
Yeah. It'd be great if the United States had the capability, the political will, the spine, blah, blah, blah. We're, you know, and we just had some weaponized, maybe some weapons, I don't know, up in the sky, in space, whatever. And we just coordinate all of them to be above certain enemy assets all over the world. Just saying. You know, they're above Iranian assets, their nuclear facilities. Anywhere that anybody that would attack us, any of their nuclear facilities, anything. And then we could make the threat, well, Iran, we're going to blow you out of the sky. In 24 hours, we're going to turn you to glass. 24 hours, you have to decouple from Hamas, decouple from Hezbollah, and GTFO, or we are going to obliterate you. And if anyone even so much as flinches towards your general direction, they will get the exact same response. And then we just show them postcards, basically, of our weaponry above their assets. I don't know. That would be nice, but we can't do that because, you know, we get upset over pancake syrup. Right. Thought we were going to have flying cars in that. Nope. Instead, we got somebody at Health and Human Services who's a dude, but says he's a chick. Okay. Anyway. So they don't get to tell us anything. And if they've threatened direct retaliation, first off, if they launch a strike on Israel, Israel will attack their nuclear facilities. And Iran doesn't want that. That's why they've used these proxy groups for so long. But one of the reasons that they're also kind of in this position is some of the proxy groups have been wondering, literally aloud on X, what are they getting out of this? What are they getting out of this situation? What are they getting out of this little setup? They've been wondering that. So, I mean, I think it's, you know, they're trying to figure out, well, we've been doing this for such a long time. What's the give and take here? We don't want to just be your attack dogs. What do we get? And they've actually been questioning that publicly. So Iran's was kind of, they're in a bit of a sticky wicket, as it were. Because that general in Damascus, that was a pretty baller move. That was kind of a checkmate move there. And I don't care if Iran thinks that the United States was involved in it. Iran has killed so many of our American soldiers. I have a friend who doesn't have legs because of an Iranian mine. So no. They don't get to sit here and tell the United States, you don't, who is you? Sit down. We kill our enemies on Christmas. Going back to the Revolutionary War. They wake up in the middle of the night, the Hessians, and we murk them. So just saying, that's something to keep an eye on for sure. I wanted to share this with you. I think we have audio of this. Did you guys see, first off, my friend Dave Burge, I don't know if you guys have heard the leopard eating party. You know what I'm going with this. Kane, the face eating party or whatever. So it's a meme. It's pretty old. And this Twitter user, this was back in like 2015. And this applies here. Somebody tweeted, quote, "I never thought leopards would eat my face," sobs a woman who voted for the leopards eating people's faces party. I feel like that's applicable in this story that I'm about to share with you. This is at UC Berkeley. So the dean of the law school dean at UC Berkeley invited some of the law students over to his house for dinner with him and his wife. It's the Oakland home of Erwin Chemerinsky. And it was the first of three dinners that they had planned to host. But then Malek Afanay, who was the co-president of Berkeley Law Students for Justice in the fake place called Palestine, rose to protest the school's investment in arms manufacturers for Israel. And then the law school professor, Catherine Fisk, who is Chemerinsky's wife, was filmed trying to take the woman's cell phone out of her hand as she filmed. And she was like, "This is our house." And these people, the students go, "You violated our constitutional rights." Wow. Someone give them, they need a refund on anything that they paid learning about law at UC Berkeley. Yeah, we need the refund. Screw you. Give us our money back, you rat welfare bastards. Done with this. I'm not apologizing for my Portuguese either. Sometimes it's got to be said, y'all. I'm not Big Bird, okay? Not here to entertain y'all's kids, saying a sermon. And it amazes me because the wife is like, "This is our home. What did you think was going to happen?" So again, my friend Dave Burgeon said, "I can't believe the leopards ate my face," said the professor who hosted the leopards eating people's faces party in his backyard. Like, what in the world did you think was going to happen? They're like, "Oh, you violated our constitutional rights." You don't have constitutional rights at someone's private house in their backyard. You don't have constitutional rights to go into somebody's house and start yelling. Filming. Yeah, while you're filming. And the wife says, "This is not your house, it's my house, and I want you to leave." And so they start saying, "Get out of our house, get out of our house, blah, 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 blah. You have to leave, blah, blah, blah." And they just, I mean, first off, that's just trashy to do that to somebody else's house. But I expect nothing less from people who think it's okay to attack your sovereign neighbor to the north and rape people to death because your attempts at colonization over land that was given to you like a welfare benefit in 2005 were unsuccessful because you stupidly decided to elect a terrorist group to turn things into the hellscape that it is now. And so it just was a hot mess. Do we have any video? Do we have some of this? It just ended up being a hot mess.
I don't know if there's any cussing in it or not.
Oh yeah. But what did they think was going to happen? And then the one student goes that she felt assaulted by Fisk. "You felt assaulted? Are you serious?" She said, "Yeah, we felt assaulted." And she says, "The aggression with which she ran at me, she saw my hijab and that was a risk for her. Wait a minute. No, I think she saw the fact that you stood up and began disrupting their private event. Actually, why am I defending them? Let them eat each other. I don't care. This is what happens. You made your bed and lie in it. Rah, rah, rah. There you go. This is what happens. Right? What did you think was going to happen? You had this kind of event at your house. But the one chick with the, that has the, she's like, yeah, she saw my hijab. And that was, well, she saw your hijab at school. And then she saw it when she invited you to her home for dinner. And then she saw it again when you stood up and you decided to ruin the dinner and disrupt everything and be a horrible guest and show a complete lack of gratitude for being given a free meal and invited to someone's home. For crying out loud. But yeah, let them eat each other up. I don't care. This is what happens. You play stupid games, you win stupid prizes. The leopards eating faces party. There it is. Right there. You know what? Maybe that should be a real party. I'm supposed to answer this questionnaire that one of our team members at Radio America sent. And I do not like questionnaires. And like one of the questions, like, what are you obsessed with? And I'm like, I'm not obsessed with anything, really. But now I kind of am obsessed with the leopards eating faces party. If I'm thinking about it.
I don't think that qualifies.
I want to make those buttons. The leopard eating faces party. It's my party.
You can put patch ops on it. That's what we need to do.
We need, patch ops. We need like the leopards eating faces party, like official merch. Because that sounds like something I could get behind. You know what I mean? Exactly. Could you not get behind that? Like, I don't even know who their candidate would be. Screw no labels, man. It's the Leopard Eating Faces party. That's where it's all at. Thanks for watching The Dana Show. Make sure to like, subscribe, ring the bell, and stay tuned for more content.